to the college. Mark Switzer, and today for our fourth lesson, we've invited Will Lyon, who's the guitar teacher at St. John Episcopal Day School. I'm particularly proud of Will because he was my student at Florida Southern College, and he's become a great teacher and a great performer, and he's here to share some of his guitar playing and guitar knowledge with us.
Hello and welcome to the HCC Virtual Classroom Guitar Series. My name is William Lyon and I am glad to be here with you today. I'm going to be playing a piece of music by Francesco Tárrega. It is a composition, Capricho, Árabe. Francesco Tárrega is one of Spain's most important composers and was a romantic composer born in 1852 in Villarreal, in northern Spain, northeastern Spain. He, as a child, was under the care of his nanny and escaped her care and ended up falling into a drainage ditch and somehow injuring his head. Either a head injury or an infection he got from the drainage ditch led to his eyesight starting to fail. His father thought it would be a great idea if he studied music so he could be guaranteed to make a good living, even if he did go completely blind. His father was a flamenco guitarist and played other styles of guitar as well. And so he thought it would be a great idea to find some blind or visually impaired music teachers for his son. He did insist his son study guitar and piano because at the time he was born, the guitar was not as prominent of a concert instrument as he would be influential in making it such. He decided to study piano and guitar and became proficient in both by the time he was an early teen. And his proficiency in piano would later become very important in his works, contributing to the classical guitar repertoire, because a lot of things that he contributed were transcriptions that use his expertise on the keyboard to transcribe them to be played on the instrument he was so passionate about. When he was 10, he started to study with Manuel Ruiz, and he was a blind guitar player. And he also had some lessons with Julian Arcus, who, when he heard him play, convinced his father to let young Tárrega move with him to Barcelona and begin to study in Barcelona with Arcus. Shortly after he got to Barcelona with Arcus, after a few lessons, Arcus went on concert tour and left. And at that point, young Francesco decided he was old enough to go out and try to make some money of his own and began playing with different groups of musicians around different pubs and places like that, trying to earn a little bit of money and get his musical career going. His father found out what was going on and promptly went and returned him back to Villarreal. And again, he ran away another time and went and lived with the gypsies for a little while, so the story goes. And his father again tracked him down. And by the time he was in his early 20s, he went to Madrid to study at the conservatory, where he was a piano student and a composition student of Arrieta. Now, around this time, Torres had redesigned the guitar, taking it out of the Romantic style and Baroque style guitar, which had a much smaller body and a neck that was actually parallel with the table and not a fingerboard that was on top. And it was a much quieter instrument and thought to be more suited towards accompanying a singer and not so well suited for a solo recital or a solo concert. So as Tárrega was continuing to be torn between piano and guitar studies, he gave a recital on a Torres guitar. And Arrieta, his teacher at the time, heard him, and after hearing him play and seeing his passion and his relationship with the instrument, how he really literally became one with the instrument and really captured all the nuances that are capable with this newly designed Torres guitar, he encouraged young Tárrega to abandon the piano and focus solely on guitar, which was a very wise set of of advice to give to him, because now we look at Tárrega as basically the father of the modern classical guitar. He set our technique really well in the right hand and the left hand, and over his lifetime slowly shortened his nails down to where they were almost non-existent by the time he left us in 1909. He liked the much more mellow tone of the shorter nail. The nail was basically as long as the fingertip, so when the finger was placed on the string and pushed down, it would push just a little bit of flesh away and expose a tiny bit of nail, giving a little bit more attack sound and a nice mellow tone. But because Torres's guitar was louder, the nails weren't as necessary to project the sound towards an audience. So we are very fortunate that Arrieta pushed Tárrega into focusing on the guitar. At that point, he decided to start composing, and I think he wrote around 76 to 80 pieces in his lifetime that were published, and we are still very much part of the guitar repertoire today. The piece I'm going to play for you today is kind of a tip of the hat to the Moorish influence in Spain, and it's called Capricho Árabe, and it's a very beautiful piece, and it was one of his first published works. Actually, in 1880 he published that piece, and he wrote his last piece just 13 days before he passed, and so he was a fairly proficient composer. But that's not all he contributed to the guitar, because still to this day a lot of the guitar repertoire is things transcribed from other instruments, and Tárrega transcribed an immense amount of works for the guitar from Chopin and Beethoven and Bach keyboard pieces. And he uses expertise that he gained studying piano as a youth to bring that over to the instrument that was his most naturally expressive, being the guitar. I hope you enjoy Capricho Árabe. Thank you. So, a good thing when you're performing is to not wear a shirt with buttons on it, so it buzzes on the back of your guitar. Quick little tip. This piece, very fun to learn. I had been waiting to awaken this piece for a long time. I made sure that I had the technical ability to play it well enough to stay with Pepe's motto, don't wake up a sleeping piece if you're just gonna murder it. So I carried this piece with me a long time and listened to a lot of different people play that I really admire. And obviously Pepe Romero is somebody that I really admire, and watching and listening to his relationship evolve with this piece over the years has been really fascinating. You listen to him play it when he's young and it's very, very different than the performances he's given recently in New York and things, where it's just really, really just cultivated like a fine wine with him. It's become a good friend, and I'm wanted to make friends with this piece for a long time, but I didn't want the relationship to start off badly. So there are some technical challenges to playing this piece well. Some of the scale runs, for sure, and the position shifts. There's some accelerandos, the use of a rubato, slowly slowing down, slowly speeding up. These are more advanced interpretive techniques when you're a solo artist on an instrument. And so one of the things I think would be beneficial if you're playing or working this piece up is to be breaking it down in your head into some, the basic parts are the very dramatic introduction, okay? And it itself has some challenges with the harmonics, and then the pull-offs. But that little rhythm at the end, I hear a lot of people, which does not give you that really important rhythm is being introduced there. And so you want to make sure that if you are doing rubato or rolling arpeggios, that it actually works with the piece. Another really challenging part of the introduction is the cello-esque appoggiando with the thumb here. And then the descending scale has an accelerando and an 8-note section. And this, with a glissando up, this was very challenging for me, and one of the reasons why I left the piece alone for as long as I did, until I had my scales and my rest strokes and my position shifts clean and felt like I could play the piece well and do it justice. So there's some tricks to playing it like swing rhythm that can help you get more comfortable with the speed that is involved there. And the accelerando and the crescendo happen on the hardest part of that scale run. So it is rather difficult, and you need to practice it slowly and get your fingerings really secure, and then slowly work it up to a tempo where you can play the passage rather musically, starting softly, getting a little louder, and speeding up, and then slowing down again at the end. So that's just one of the technical parts of the introduction that I found to be rather challenging. Now, one of the things Tárrega was known for was playing accompaniment free stroke and melody rest stroke. And I hear a lot of people, and I was guilty of this in the beginning too, playing this melody. Right? Where's the melody? Where's the harmony? Right? Is the melody? No, it's. So this is all harmony notes. So Tárrega would play that melody note rest stroke with his eight, and then free stroke on the harmonies, just to bring that melody out and let the harmonies not be so important and compete with the melody. That's another really important tip when you're playing Tárrega's music, is his use of free stroke and rest stroke on the melodic notes. And so I found that to be very useful in bringing that melody out. And let's see, what are the other challenging parts of this piece? When you start this piece in D minor, use a lot of the D harmonic minor, and then we have this. And to play this stretch and these bars cleanly and in tempo was definitely a challenge for me too. And again, it's just relaxation, building the relaxation into your fingerings. Seems very familiar and natural to me, but in the beginning there was a lot of tension. So you do your stretching exercises and all the things that, you know, help you get into these precarious positions and make them feel like, oh yeah, I was meant to do that. So that was another challenging part that I think a lot of us who have worked on this piece kind of struggle with. Another one is the long scale that is a chromatic modulation from the minor to the parallel major, from D minor to D major. And that was gone through the fifth. You have your A, your dominant note there, and it's left hanging. And then with this guitar especially, is to play that scale. I started with the free stroke with my right hand on the wound strings. And as I get to the unwound string, I switch to rest stroke. And that helps me to crescendo through that, whereas naturally the instrument's louder on the wound string, so it's more difficult to play softly and crescendo from wound strings up to the nylon that are unwound. And so I found that working the speed and the free stroke on the wound strings and then switching to that rest stroke for the last two strings really helps to bring that out. And we'll see if I can give you a better example. And here we're established in the major key. That is definitely a tricky part of the piece, but an exciting part of the piece, fun to play, and you feel like you've arrived somewhere when you get to that D major. And so that was, I hope you find that a little bit useful when you're working on this piece. As far as the form of it, it's pretty straightforward. And after you play through the major, it returns back to the minor for the end of the piece. And I think it is a beautiful nod to the Moors and their influence on Northern Spain. And again, I hope you enjoyed Capricho Árabe, and I encourage you to look more into Francesco Tárrega. He's got several levels of pieces. There's pieces for just about anybody. I have young students working on Lagrima right now, which is a very beautiful piece. Which, you know, the story is his daughter passed, and word got to him, and he went out on concert stage and actually just improvised what he was feeling about that. If it's not true, it ought to be. It's a beautiful story. And so Francesco's contribution to guitar and its repertoire is not only virtuosic pieces, but there's very simple, small little gems that are just impregnated with his passion and his feelings that he was expressing. He was a very shy person and did not like to play for big crowds and big audiences. He much preferred playing for his friends or for small recitals. And he always kept his home open to all of his friends, regardless of their social or economic status. And this was kind of a fault to him in a little bit because he always struggled economically. He was born to a humble means and humble family, and he died a very poor man. But later in his life, he actually became paralyzed on the right side of his body for a few years, and it took him a while to return to the concert stage, which he did. He did recover and he did return. But in those years, he was struggling to make money, and all those friends that he kept his home open to and were kind of like hanging around with him actually stepped up and returned the favor and made sure that he was okay economically, as well as a fortunate meeting with a few wealthy people who really took the artist under his wing to be a patron of the arts and support him. So I encourage you to look more into Francesco Tárrega and his music and learn some of it, play it, enjoy it. And thank you for spending some time with us today.